Next speaker is Ivan Ramirez from Tacoma Community College, USA, whose talking title is Open, Accessible, and Inclusive Lecture Tutorials for Industry Astronomy. Is there, if
I am here, yes. Yeah.
Please proceed.
Thank you, and thanks everyone for being here. I am going to share my screen first. Are you seeing my PowerPoint?
Okay, very well.
Thank you. Yeah, so thanks everyone for being here. My name is Ivan Ramirez. I'm a PhD in astronomy, originally from Peru, and I am an astronomy professor at Tacoma Community College, which is in the state of Washington in the United States. So what I would like to share with you today is essentially a collection of materials that for the teaching of introductory astronomy at the college level, which are open, accessible, and inclusive, and I'm going to go through what that means exactly. And if you want to take a look at those materials already, you can go to the link on the slide. I have also posted the link on the chat, so you can already go take a look at what's available there. It is still a work in progress, but I'll present what I've done so far and the philosophy behind it. So lecture tutorials are short activities, a few pages long, that we typically give students after a short lecture. They are active learning activities which begin with relatively simple questions that reinforce definitions or present key ideas, and then later on get into addressing some of the common misconceptions that students have, as students develop this new knowledge, they get to apply it and eventually get challenged with much more complex questions near the end. They also allow us to practice critical thinking in the classroom collaboratively, ideally. There is peer instruction happening during this time, and as instructors, we get a wonderful opportunity to do some formative assessment so we can adapt our lecture or our class as we progress through the term by seeing how our students are performing during this time. And usually we end up with some wrap-up test sample problems or something that shows the students that these activities are actually beneficial for their learning and their success in our courses. So all the work that I'm sharing falls under the OER framework, the Open Educational Resource Framework, which is a lot more than just being free. Strictly speaking, an OER material is a work that is published officially, either in the public domain or with an open license. And the value of that is that you give users a permission upfront to be able to use your materials without really having to ask for permission. The permission has already been given. It's more than that also, because not only people can use your materials, they can use different materials, combine them, and create what works for them in their particular classrooms or whatever they are using those materials for. People can also share whatever they create based on other previous materials that they use. So very organically, this work leads into up-to-date, high-quality, and highly improved materials. Open educational resources remove barriers. They allow us to approach an equitable instruction, and they also allow us to be creative and inspire people in certain ways. So the picture on this slide is a chart of stellar evolution that one of my students made as a project for the class. And This student shared this as an open educational resource with a Creative Commons license. And sometime later, this same picture appeared on the Wikipedia Stellar Evolution page. So we can give students a lot of power in that way. They will feel good about their work being highlighted that way, for example. So how to do it exactly can be a little tricky. There are some convoluted ideas behind it, perhaps. So my recommendation for this to do it properly would be to talk to your OER specialist if you have one at your institution. Probably your librarian is an OER specialist, and if not, they'll be more than happy to learn about it. And you can find plenty of information about this. all the work, like I said, about all the work that I'm sharing with you is OER, so you can also use it as an example of how that is properly done. Since I work in the United States, I use Creative Commons heavily, so that is the way we normally adapt and employ OER here. And there might be different versions of that for whichever country you're in. So the picture here is the front page for one of my PowerPoint slides, which are also part of this work. One of the things that you might notice right at the very beginning is that we have an attribution here to the astronomy textbook by OpenStax, and it says that this work is a derivative of it. To a large extent, the work that I'm presenting here is attached to OpenStax, but it also contains other things that I have taken from different sources, so they are properly attributed, whatever and whenever they appear. Accessibility refers to the process of designing courses and developing a teaching style that includes people with disabilities, often through the use of technology. So everything that I'm sharing with you is accessible to a certain extent, which means, for example, that all of the documents are machine readable. The structure is understood. The structure of the document is understood through the use of headings, proper listing and tables. The math is done with accessible software and all that. Astronomy, as we probably know, has many, many pictures and diagrams, movies, simulations, and whatnot. All graphics have been all texted, so they all have alt text. That means they can all be also read. There is a description, a textual description of what the different pictures and graphs are showing in the slides, in the videos, in the lecture tutorials, and basically everywhere. The work that I'm sharing also has a bunch of videos. I'm sharing, I'll show you maybe later, a playlist on YouTube where you can find all of these lecture videos. They're all closed captioned and closed captioned accurately. So they're actually being closed captioned using script. So the script is written before recording the lecture. And so they're accurate. They include punctuation, which is very important for closed captions, for example. All of this work is done with accessibility in mind, or has been designed with accessibility in mind. It is prepared to implement universal design for learning, so to allow students to gather information and learn in the way that works best for them, and also to for them to show us how they understand and what they have learned in many different ways. So one of the very important things about accessibility is that is a practice that helps everyone, not only people with disabilities, even though that is the main motivation for doing that. So some time ago, I encountered a question that looks similar to the one that I'm showing on the slide right now. And it said, the HR diagram is a graph of, and then we have three options: A, mass versus radius, B, temperature versus luminosity, C, H versus position. Most of you would probably know the answer to this question, but what this question told me, or one of the things that I kind of thought about this question was that, well, it's not a very deep question to begin with. It's more of a definition question, but sometimes we need those. But more importantly, it was telling me that there's something in this question that is really irrelevant to a class that is about critical thinking, that is about developing this you know, process of science kind of thing. And so someone who might be more interested in, who might apply some critical thinking to this question, might ask, well, what is HR? What is HR stand for? And as many of you probably know, that stands for Hertzsprung and Russell. So that's the names of two astronomers. That led me to think about, as many of you have probably done, who gets to be represented in astronomy. It's mostly white men from Western Europe and the United States, Hertzsprung and Russell, two white men. It's something that you can also easily verify by doing a Google search for greatest astronomers. You get a result like the one shown on the screen. So this perpetuates the notion that only cisgender white males can be great astronomers. In my work, I have tried to be very intentional about highlighting the work of those who have been excluded traditionally from our field. An example of that is shown on the screen here. There's a page from one of the slides. It's about the chemical composition of stars, and they make a big point about Cecilia Payne-Gaposchkin and her discovery of the chemical composition of the sun, which was discredited in some ways by Russell, the R in HR diagram. I mentioned that in the lecture, and in my actual classroom, I would actually follow that up with a little discussion about what's going on here, and try to connect it to a more modern kind of development of the same type of problem, which is a sexism problem, of course. When we present it in the lecture, it might seem something from the 1920s, this doesn't happen anymore. This is a very old thing that is not happening. But there are things, for example, like this paper from Clancy et al. Just a few years ago, demonstrating that women experience gender discrimination at high rates, and even higher rates for women of color. So you can bring this up as part of the discussion. And this is certainly a little awkward sometimes, because it kind of cuts into the flow of simply talking about astronomy, simply talking about the science. It takes, at least it took me some time to develop this confidence to say, well, I'm going to spend some time in my class to have this meaningful social justice conversations. If this means cutting some content, well, so what? It's a very important thing to discuss in a classroom, especially an introductory science classroom. We also often have seen this now appear more often in resources, educational resources, the inclusion of indigenous science. However, something that I've also noticed is that very often this is included as folklore or tradition, as opposed to what it truly is, which is science. It's just real science. The process of science is pretty simply explained as a process of careful observations, testing hypotheses and ideas, and then transmit that information to future generations. And this is what indigenous scientists have been doing for a very long time. So my favorite example of this, and there's many others in my materials, but one of my favorites is about the word planet, which we will find them everywhere as the ancient Greek word for wanderer. You can find similar words for it from other cultures, like native Andean people call the planets walking or traveling stars. Cree Native Americans call them the moose spirit, because moose do this loopy kind of motion when they get scared. And remember how important this one observation is. This observation that there are little dots in the sky who are moving, wandering, traveling, or moving like a moose. It leads to the discussion of heliocentric versus geocentric. It leads to the theory of gravity at some point. So it is science, and it should be presented that way. Finally, I want to also mention that maybe there is a way of being a little bit more radical in our approach to inclusion. And this is my attempt at doing that. as you might notice, if you navigate through my Google Drive that I've shared there in the chat, that I have removed many of the usual names that are attached to, you know, the famous laws of physics and astronomy, intentionally. Not because we have anything against those people, but more because of what the ultimate message of that might be for a student. So you would probably identify all of these laws in the slide, laws of motion, call it the law of inertia, force law, the action-reaction law. Not only we're removing one of the barriers that we put into our instruction or one of our biases in there, but we're also being more explicit about what those laws are. So we're making it a little bit easier for students. We call them laws of planetary motion, law of ellipses, areas, the harmonic law for what you probably know what those are about, radiation laws, temperature luminosity diagram. You can imagine what that is since we have the discussion of the Hertzsprung-Russell thing. And notice there's still Leavitt's law there, which is Henrietta Leavitt, of course, that's for the period luminosity relation. Remember I mentioned being very intentional about including those who have been excluded traditionally. So that one stays. And the last one here in this list is the law of expansion. You can imagine this is about Hubble's law. Another opportunity to have a discussion with your students, a meaningful discussion with your students here is to bring up, for example, this article. This is an article about Hubble and the fact that he was a racist. So you can go and take a look at that. So one of the discussions that you can have with students at this point is like to think about how the astronomy community was okay with naming their most important space telescope after a racist. So in conclusion, final thoughts here, the work that I've done over the past 4+ years at Tacoma Community College, supported by my colleagues, is open, is accessible, it is inclusive, it's available on that Google Drive. So please go ahead and download it, use it, mix it, modify it, improve it. I'll also just like to tell everyone that, you know, what I've been seeing in the past few days from you, the things that you're presenting is just a lot of amazing stuff out there that I would really like to use. And it would be even easier for me to use it if you were to share it as an OER resource. So learning about OER and how to properly share our content, it would be a great idea. Always think about accessibility when designing courses and educational materials as it benefits everyone, not just students with disabilities. And I would like to encourage everyone to think about your approach to inclusion and try to be a little more radical on it. My contact information is there at the very end. And thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Ben. Because there is rather short time to left, so could you give some question or comment, short one? Now, no question and comments are there, so please fill it immediately. Ivan, I have a comment. There is also the expression of the planet in Japanese or Chinese, using a Chinese character. And many people say that it is wandering star, but some people say it is a playing star.
That's wonderful. I would like to hear more about that.
And I'd like to show the Chinese character, but I cannot now.
Great. It was at some point I would like to turn that into some sort of project for students to find out what different people around the world call the planets. And no one should be surprised that we all had similar terms for it.
Yeah.
Something that expresses that idea that is a little dot that is traveling in the sky. A really critical, crucial observation in the history of science that it's not just one night observing. It takes many nights, months of really careful observation, or years even to get to that. kind of knowledge.
Okay, now time is up, so thanks.